Well, hey there, idiots. Welcome back to Observe. In today's video, we're going to be analyzing the nonverbal communication of Trisha Paytas in regards to everything that has been going on with Colleen Ballinger. More on that in just a second. Let's go ahead and roll the intro first. Okay, for those of you who do not know, which is probably not many of you, but for those of you who do not know, this is not the first video on the Colleen situation, so if you would like to be able to go and check those other ones out, that will give you some more context as to what is happening here. Also, this is not the first video that I have done on Trisha, so if you would like to be able to get some of the information from those, go and check those videos out as well. I have linked all of them in the description of this video to make it a little bit more accessible for you. However, this video today is Trisha addressing Colleen. I have not seen this video. I wanted to be able to also react to this one as organically as I possibly can. So let's just go ahead and dive into the content itself.
So this is a video that I like really did not want to make. And I feel like the past few years, I've really taken a step back from having to comment on everything, having to respond to everything said about me on the internet, because at the end of the day, it just gets really exhausting. And then, of course, being in other people's business, even if I have strong opinions about it, I really decided years ago that it wasn't good for my mental health. I have a mental illness, I have a personality disorder, which is hard to regulate my emotions. I get triggered very easily. So I've learned to deal with triggers the past few years, and I feel like I've done a very good job managing and regulating emotional stability.
All right, so I'm going to go ahead and pause here. So far, there's nothing that's sticking out to me as far as what might be a set design manipulation point or anything along those lines. This isn't an apology either. This is just going to be addressing Colleen and the situation around that. So we'll be able to honestly gather more information as the time goes on. What I am noticing is that she has a number of dry swallows in there. This could be a level of nerves or nervousness centered around what she's creating here. We're also seeing some eye rolls in there, which is dismissive behavior around some of this while she's talking about her own mental health. And for those of you who are not aware, Trisha does have a history of being involved in some of the drama circles, so this does make sense contextually so far. But these are just some of the small things that I'm noticing so far. Let's go ahead and just keep watching.
And on top, aside from all that, just, you know, being known as the person who's just always in drama and can't keep friendships, it's not a good look. I've worked really hard the past couple of years to kind of just stay in my own lane and not engage in anything online, which is commonly referred to as drama. But I feel like this is beyond drama. I'm putting my own hurt feelings aside, and my feelings are very hurt.
I'm going to go ahead and pause here. So in this little part here, you could see that she has a little flash of disgust in regards to what she's talking about. And that's just something to be able to make note of, that she is emoting across her face as she's trying to say this. So far, I haven't seen anything that's desynchronized. Along with that, the flow of her words is fairly stilted and fairly broken. I'm not seeing a lot of cuts in this video. It seems as though she wanted to be able to just sit down and talk. And again, the things that she's pointing out here about wanting to stay out of the drama spheres, so to speak, for some past years here are fairly accurate from at least my own experience. I have not seen anything popping up from Trisha's side of the court that has been even considered problematic here recently. So she has been doing that fairly well. Let's see what the situation with Colleen really has invoked from this. And yeah, we'll just see what happens.
Sick to my stomach feeling for a while now, and today especially. Me and Colleen started a podcast this year, 3 episodes. We were always friends.
Little bit of contempt coming in there when she says the 3 episodes portion, along with the raising of the eyebrows. So that raising of the eyebrows is an emphasizing gesture or expression. So when we're seeing that along with the contempt, then there's something that's packed behind that. The 3 episodes, something is weighted behind that. We would want to be able to find out what that is. I'm sure it's because of everything that's going on now that things fell apart. Perhaps there's more to it than that. At least Trisha has a level of intellectual or moral superiority in regards to that. Let's keep watching.
He's friendly before. I think it shocked a lot of people because, like, oh, I didn't know they were close friends like that. And the thing is we weren't close friends. We were friends. I considered us to be friendly. When I had my daughter, she reached out and I thought, oh, it's great to have mom friends and, you know, friends, you know, who have kids. So I thought this podcast would be great because we always got along really great when we would see each other. We've been doing videos together on and off, like maybe once a year.
Pausing again here, throughout that area, we're talking about the friendship and relationship status between Trisha and Colleen. A lot of insecurity gestures coming from Trisha on that part, with a lot of the shrugging and breaking of eye contact. Again, those don't push me to have a lot of confidence in what she's saying, but not in that she might be lying, but that there might be something more that she's not talking about in this area, or at least feeling in this area that she's not trying to be able to emote here. There go those little slips and shrugs that are coming in there. So there's something that is behind the relationship between her and Colleen that we're not necessarily privy to right here, at least at this portion in the video. But still, again, so far, there hasn't been anything to be like, oh, well, there's a desynchronization point. There hasn't even been the possibility or the need for her to actually bend the truth or lie. So right now, it's just a matter of continuing forward.
Once a year since 2018. And so I, you know, I just thought, well, this is a good podcast to get to know each other. It's a good, you know, a little thing for me to do because I haven't really done anything for a couple of years and I really enjoy being creative and producing stuff. And it was kind of fun to do costumes and stuff. I wasn't aware of these most recent things that are coming out. Everyone knows I have a very, very, very firm stance on talking to anyone underage, platonic or not. I've always been very, very firm with this, that I think it's inappropriate. I've been known to talk about many occasions where someone is just 17 years old and I don't feel comfortable with them, you know, being around them, hanging out with them. I remember one time there was a very popular YouTuber who was 17 and another YouTuber I was friends with wanted to bring her to my apartment. I said, absolutely not. I'm like, she has to just stay in the car. Like, I have a lot of trauma when it comes to my relationships I had when I was underage.
Okay, I'm going to go ahead and pause here. We're seeing a number of manipulators and self-soothing gestures come out, especially around this area. And that could be because her hair might be tickling her face and needs to correct that, just has an itch, something along those lines. It is popping up in areas that could be more agitating in the conversation itself. So it's something to keep our eye on. Along with that, we're seeing some other self-soothers and manipulators that pop up around that. We're seeing a consistent swivel back and forth in her chair as she's talking. So if things continue forward and we see that suddenly stop or spike up more, that could be an area of extra agitation. And could be an indicator of some extra baggage behind things. So we're keeping our eye on all of these different things. And we're also hearing her talk about her stance on underage, like interacting with underage people in general. Again, so far, I'm not seeing anything that's pointing me away from what she's saying. So we're just going to keep plugging through this video.
And not always sexual. A lot of my trauma comes from school. Authorities at school, teachers at school that I trusted. And sorry, this is like hard for me to make. I'm really trying to, it's a very hard, but like boundary, like it's one that I don't let up on with anybody. I think it's weird. I've talked about it multiple times. I think it's weird. So when all this came.
Okay, I'm seeing a consistent, throughout all of this, I'm seeing a very consistent no shake in here. And the point of view that Trisha is placing out at this point is one that she might say feels unbelievable. You might not believe, or it's unbelievable that I'm having to say this. So that no shake in there does make sense. It doesn't feel like it's a disconnect or a desynchronization between what she's saying and what she's displaying. So I am noting that in there. I'm also noting the occasional shrugs and again, eye breakings and areas like that where she's talking about how weird she feels like certain things might be. And so all of these things are just helping me understand a little bit more as to what her psychological processing is behind this, to understand, is this something that Trisha is coming forward authentically with, or is this something that is just there? Is this just a video to lash out at Colleen, something along those lines? So far, I'm not seeing any evidence to say that it's just a video to lash out at Colleen. It seems as though this is coming from an authentic place. There's enough indicators of agitation and nervousness in there to push me towards authenticity, especially regarding the substance of the video itself. But let's keep continuing through.
When all this came out, I was shocked, you know. You know, the group chats and stuff, I was kind of shocked. And it's such a difficult thing because Colleen is someone that I quickly, literally in the past month that we did this podcast, like I really, really like cared about and really like related to. I thought, well, you know, she told me she'd get canceled here and there. And she kind of understood when people would come for her for working with me, you know, because I've done stuff in my past that's, you know, not cool by today's standards, you know? And I think...
Fascinating. During that time, we're seeing a narrowing in Trisha's eyes as she's talking about things that she's done. A little bit of action in the corner of her nose. Narrowing the eyes equals scorn. Corner of the nose equals disgust. And both of those emotional responses to the things that she's done in the past is actually encouraging to be able to see. Perhaps Trisha has taken some strides to try to move past the drama that really encapsulated her life earlier on, especially in her YouTube career. So seeing those emotional displays in regards to that is encouraging to see. Again, it's not pointing me away from authenticity. It is pointing me in the direction towards she's likely telling the truth and being authentic here. Let's keep watching.
Oh, and I think everyone can take accountability and grow. Like, I really do think people can like change and change their ways and stuff like that. If you can acknowledge it. Her video came out and I was just shocked, to say the least, that she didn't at least acknowledge the stuff that her own fans were saying, how they felt, you know, to kind of brush it over in the way she did. And, you know, ultimately became like memes and now it becomes somewhat lighthearted, even though it's not a lighthearted issue. I was shocked. And she sent me the link to her video, her apology video, and I didn't respond back to it because I was shocked. Weeks prior to the apology video, I know we were staying in touch because, again, I know what it feels like to have the whole internet come down on you, even if the whole internet is right. Like, I'm someone, again, who struggles with mental health issues, mental illness, and I know what that can feel like, and I know I don't want anyone, guilty or not, to ever feel like they don't have someone to talk to, that there's not a way out of a situation, that there's not.
Seeing a little bit of defensiveness creep into Trisha's nonverbal communication during this time, with a lot more of the hunching down and closing off of her neck area. That area is vulnerable. Evolutionarily speaking, we'll protect it when feeling defensive. So we're seeing that come in here. We're also seeing her lean back a fair bit. The chair swivel is staying consistent. We're not seeing any spikes in that area. We're still seeing the normal emotion across her face that we've been seeing pretty consistently throughout in this video. Everything that I'm seeing so far, it still is pushing me towards authenticity, but I can also feel a little bit of defensiveness when she's coming to this portion where she's talking about still interacting with Colleen, regardless of the situation at hand and whether or not she's innocent or guilty, blah, blah, blah. We're seeing that pop in there. So there was at least somewhat, on some level, a moral struggle for her in that, which it seems as though she still did decide to try to stick by Colleen at the time. Yeah, let's just keep watching.
Not a way to make a situation right. So I kind of stay in touch with her, but when I got involved with this, I got dragged into it rather. It was a few weeks ago, and two boys, both, one I believe was 20 at the time, and one who was 14 at the time, both the 14-year-old's alleged, because I didn't speak on this because I didn't see anything. And not to say that I don't believe this person, it's just a very, very very serious allegation. It's very illegal. So I was kind of waiting to see what would kind of come out of anything before I had to make this video and this statement. Literally my account.
What I will note was fascinating about as she is listing the ages of these two boys, the 20-year-old one, she has no verbal difficulties actually stating the age of, but when it comes around to the person who is 14, there's a lot of stammers, a lot of halts, and a lot of stutters in there as she's trying to get these words out. And that uncertainty that creeps in there as well just lets us know that there's a psychological battle that's going on as she's stating this. She's uncomfortable with that statement a little bit beyond the other one. And this does still boil back around to the age difference side of things. So we're getting a better understanding as to how Trisha's going to be behaving throughout this video. We're seeing some of these tells, some of the emotional backgrounds of things. Let's just keep watching.
Literally, my accountant, I don't know why she got a text from like a Huffington Post reporter asking for a statement about all this. And I'm like, you know what, let me just put this out. And I hate putting any energy into this, but it's very, very serious. It's very serious. And it's a topic I don't take lightly and I can't take lightly as I am a full-time sex worker. I don't think that's a secret. It's not as advertised as it once was, but we already have a lot of stigma, misconceptions, allegations against us as sex workers. And so I need to nip this in the bud that I do not condone at all unsolicited nudes, sending unsolicited nudes to anyone of anybody, sex worker or not. I think using someone's nudes as a way to hurt them, make fun of them, make light of them, be mean is the lowest form of human, the lowest form of intelligence. I think that's so inhumane. I think that's so disgusting for anyone.
Gonna go ahead and pause here. So the emotional display is synchronized with the verbal display that she's presenting here. A lot of disgust coming into her face. Along with that, again, the narrowing of the eyes with scorn and even further into the eyebrows as well as they're drawing together and lowering. This is all anger, disgust, scorn. All of these emotions towards the misuse of private material like this. And so that does make sense. This is synchronized from her. And to be able to see that level of emotional backing to that is also just, it's heartening to be able to see somebody care about something. So we're seeing this. We're just going to keep watching.
One. Last night, the text messages were shown. And it's very clearly from Colleen to a fan, has over 500,000 views on Twitter, that I'm not embarrassed by, I'm embarrassed for her. I try to take myself out of these equations when I'm feeling triggered. And if I were to look at it as it happening to someone else, I wouldn't be humiliated for the person in the photos. I'd be humiliated for the person who sent them. Although it can be humiliating for the person in the photos as well. And it somewhat is embarrassing. I get made fun of all the time for my body, my nudes, even under this person's posts. While I'm thankful, he posted them so I could see that this is real. It's hearing all that horrible stuff underneath the photo, like about my body just being messed up or disgusting. And it's a lot. Yes, I'm a sex worker and yes, I chose this job and yes, I make money doing it. But it never feels good to have someone just like make fun of your naked body. It's just a really vulnerable thing. And it is a little embarrassing if I'm being honest, but I'm more embarrassed for her that this is the kind of person she is. Like I'm so embarrassed. Sending these to fans unsolicited, the context of which she was sending these. I don't get the purpose. I don't know if there was an inside joke I'm missing on this. The fan said, hey, congratulations on becoming parents. Which a month later, she just responds with a nude of me and says, "You look so pretty in this." And these weren't a long time ago. This is someone well into their 30s, just gave birth sending nudes. And a month prior, I was in her house meeting her child and doing a mukbang, meeting her newborn and doing a mukbang with her.
Throughout this entire segment here, the consistent emotion that keeps slipping out is disgust from Trisha. We're seeing that heavily betrayed in the corners of her nose, where you commonly see disgust creeping out. Again, the scorn sometimes slips in with the narrowing of the eyes, things like that. But that disgust is the constant strain of emotion that's going through here, which is fairly telling in regards to what she's saying as well. So these are just some of the things that we're noting here throughout this. Trisha does have some strong emotions around this. And so far, I haven't been seeing anything that's pushing me to believe that she's just making this for a sake of show or something along those lines. So let's just keep watching to see if that changes or alters in any way.
In these texts, there's also friends of hers. They showed the viewing parties that were talked about to make fun of me. They did viewing parties of my adult content to make fun of me. And there's a friend of hers who I actually met as well back in 2018 with his face posing next to explicit images of me. And there was a video of it, and it's a lot.
What I'm noticing in this area is, again, the freezing of the upper lip from Trisha. And for those of you who have not seen other videos on the channel, that freezing of the upper lip is a common indicator of genuine tears and emotion kind of creeping out across the face there. That freezing will happen very regularly. So we're seeing that here. That lets us know that Trisha is actually wrestling a certain amount of negative emotion in regards to this, and not just for show, but more so the fact that it's a difficult topic to talk about. Just more things to be able to understand. Let's keep watching.
And it wasn't just one occasion. There was multiple times that she sent just different photos in different positions of me. I did ask her about these a couple weeks ago before there was the proof, so to speak, right? And she assured me that she had never sent photos of me, that
that was fascinating there, that she had never sent photos of me. That look away and the rapid flutter blinking after that. That rapid flutter blinking usually is an indicator of very intense psychological processing. Something around that. I'm not sure if it's like perhaps Trisha was having difficulty with the word never being in there. Perhaps that there was something else behind that. There is more context behind that line, never sharing photos of me, that at least caused Trisha's nonverbal communication to spike there in regards to that line of phrasing. So that's a curiosity point to me. There's not anything that I can like look at or dig around at. Perhaps some of you in the comments know a situation. Maybe there is an exception to this, something along those lines that would have caused that nonverbal display. Right now, it's just a curiosity. I'm going to keep going through.
This one fan who was underage at the time would send photos to her. She's like, "No, he was a fan. He sent photos to me and he was obsessed with you." And he would just send me it. And once in a while, I'd like respond to him and be like, "Hey, okay." That's what she told me a couple weeks ago. There's a clip of her saying she saw a whale squirt and she wasn't talking about Trisha Paytas. I sent her that as well. And she said, "Everything's taken out of context. Like, these are lies." And being as I was like her friend and I knew her as a person, I was trusting her, I guess. Because, I mean, overall, who do you trust? Like, this person you know in real life or people you don't know anything about?
Interesting little flash of disgust centered around the trusting the trusting factor between her and Colleen as opposed to other people does indicate a little bit that Trisha has the level of distaste towards herself and trusting Colleen, understandably so, especially with everything occurring as it has and receipts and everything coming out as they have and Colleen handling it as she has. So this is understandable. Let's just keep watching.
I guess that's why there's that whole innocent until proven guilty thing. So there was two options there for her to say, like, yeah, that was a while ago. I was a hater. I mean, I'm the first to say, like, I've definitely have been a hater in the past. I've been miserable in my own life. I've been going through shit in my own life in the past. And I was miserable and I hated on people for sure. Not people that I would go and like be at their house and like do a whole podcast with, but sure, I can understand people, you know, gossiping or making fun of people. I don't understand the making fun of bodies. That's weird. It's weird. I don't get those texts at all. Like I look at those and I'm like so confused. Like, okay, I'm the joke. My naked body is the joke, I guess. Okay. I don't know. It's very odd. But I kind of gave her outs because I was...
During that time, we're seeing some manipulators, the self-soothers come in, and also some postural rechanges as she's talking about the presentation of bodies and judgment they're around and making fun of. So this is something that does obviously affect her psychologically enough. Anytime you see a postural change like that, that indicates a shift in your thinking or a shift in sometimes the roles of a conversation, something along those lines. So seeing that pop up there, that does indicate that Trisha was feeling enough to have that nervous energy enough to move, to shift her posture. So that's another indicator of authenticity during this area, that Trisha does have that actual feeling of emotion towards that. Let's keep watching.
It's because I was like, hey, like, you know, we've talked crap about me. That's fine. We weren't that close back then, I guess. Like, you know, whatever. And she vehemently denied, no, I never sent pictures of you. Like, the underage man would send me pictures of you, not specifying if they were nude or not. The text came out last night and my heart started racing. I was triggered. I haven't been triggered in a while, but I was triggered. My heart was racing, my stomach, I was sick to my stomach, and I just, I don't know, I guess seeing stuff like that, that's probably the worst I've seen from someone that I've like considered a friend. Like that's pretty barbaric. It's pretty misogynistic. And it is downright cruel. It's a low, low level of a person.
Again, scorn, disgust creeping in very heavily on Trisha's face during this time, letting us know her very strong emotional feeling and stance about what she's talking about here. Just making a note of that. Let's keep watching.
To say that stuff, and again, this isn't years ago. This is, you know, someone well into their 30s. It's not a child. It's not a kid. As of now, as of recording this, the text came out and the minor fan, who is now an adult, has said that those same pictures were sent to him. This is all alleged, as I haven't seen anything, so I don't want to. I just want to put this out ahead of anything. I know there's every day something coming out, and seeing that text from the Huffington Post, I'm like, okay, let me just get ahead of this. I am so sorry to that person if this is true. I'm so sorry. I know firsthand how traumatizing that can be. I had nothing to do with this. I do not condone it. I think it's the most disgusting thing, and above all else, illegal. And to the person she sent, who was, I think, 20 at the time, maybe 21. I still think it's disgusting. A grown woman in their 30s doing this to someone who is in their house, been around their family, like, you have some issues. It's a sickness. And I don't think this is jumping on a hate bandwagon. This is like, hey, maybe she doesn't get it. What she did was wrong. You know what I mean? Maybe it's like, okay, we need to keep talking about this because this is really wrong. This is really gross. And it's also unsolicited nudes. No one was asking for this. I don't know the inside joke. She said they're taken out of context. I don't know what the viewing parties or your friend posing next to them are like.
So during this time, I'm just trying to keep my eye to see if there's anything that's sticking out as far as straying from her nonverbal baseline, both freezing and spiking on that. And I'm not seeing anything stick out for me that we're seeing a consistent movement with the chairs. We're seeing consistent movement with her head as she's speaking, or with her head as she's speaking, and the words she's saying line up with what she's displaying nonverbally. So during all of this time, I haven't seen anything at least that's pushing me away of authenticity from Trisha at this point. It's a fairly good thing to be able to see, especially because we saw so much difficulty from Colleen in regards to these things, to be able to see somebody else come up and talk about some of this stuff and have synchronized nonverbal communication around it is good to be able to see. It helps us solidify and have more idea and context for what really did happen. So we've only got a few minutes left of this, and then we'll talk a little bit at the end.
I just had to make this video to say I don't stand behind Colleen whatsoever. Her video was not an apology. And it took away from the severity of her actions of talking to minors, bringing minors on stage at her show. These people are speaking up and they're uncomfortable for a reason. Acknowledge it, change it, do better.
Honestly, you just want to pause, and that's fair. That's fair. People were still uncomfortable for a reason. Acknowledge it, change it, and do better. It's fantastic advice. Fairly simplistic. I don't know that singing a song with a ukulele is doing any of those things. You know my opinion of that if you watched the last video on that. So, but we're going to go ahead and continue on this.
But being told she never sent these photos, and these actually do exist, these text messages, I feel like super disrespected, and at least be honest about it to like show some accountability, show like, yeah, that was stupid, that was immature, whatever. But I don't stand by her. I'm embarrassed to be associated with her. I'm embarrassed for the fans that she messaged those to. That's should never have happened. And again, this really hurts sex workers as a whole. This is out there, and it looks like we're some deviants because this is used in this way. It's disgusting. Yes, I'm a sex worker, but a lot of those images and videos were behind a paywall. One that requires someone to be 18 and over. And that's it. That is my statement on it, and I'm not going to speak on this again. I will never speak on Colleen again. She just does not exist to me anymore. And this is not me canceling her. She'll always be around. I'm sure she'll be fine. Just publicly disavowing any association I have with her.
Okay. So that's that video. The overall vibe of it felt very authentic and very down to earth. It didn't feel like it was hyper edited. Didn't feel like it had a whole lot of editing polish to it so that it came off as a production rather than just a video. So I do appreciate that throughout that we're also seeing a constant strain of disgust, perhaps contempt and scorn in regards to what is being talked about. From what I'm gathering, it seems as though there were a couple issues that Trisha was really wanting to address with the sex worker side of things and some of the details around that. And then along with that, the part of being friends with Colleen and the underage fan side of things and how that played out. And so seeing what I've been able to see here, I do believe Trisha's standpoint here. So what we're seeing here is authenticity from Trisha. And if you haven't seen the video from Colleen as well, then you can kind of compare and contrast the two differences and see what it looks like to have somebody present fairly authentic nonverbal communication as opposed to somebody playing a ukulele song addressing things. So if you want to be able to go ahead and do that, then feel free. If you do have any other comments around this or any other suggestions for videos around this entire scenario, let me know in the comments of this video below. This is a very not okay situation and not unheard of for people in positions of power to abuse their positions of power, even unintentionally or intentionally, especially when it comes to people who are underage. So this is an important topic to be able to speak about. It was good to be able to have Trisha speak her portion on things and to see the nonverbal communication behind that. But without further ado, that's all that I've got for the day. My name is Logan and you have been oh so awesome as you always are. And I will see you in the next video. Cheers, guys.